So with this background, let me introduce my topic. I've written here light inspired, and in the kind of topic that I had given to Deka sir, it was bio inspired. It's all the same. Why light inspired? I'll tell you. Journey through some contemporary challenges of energy, environment, and water research. Healthcare is not out of this. Healthcare is very much connected to this. I welcome you all to this. Now, the layout of this presentation, I hope I will have some half an hour from now. Quest for sustainable solutions to global challenges. So humanity at the crossroad, I have already told you. We are working in a biorefinery model, or have been working since 2009 and onwards. And rather, we have been inspired by one person. I was talking about him to the Honorable Director, Dr. Prabhakant Sinha, who actually made a lot of changes in my life as well, in my thought process. He is our alumnus of IIT Kharagpur, I think passed out in 1969. Then he went abroad in the US, he established a company. He was the founding managing director and chairman of Z Associates. You might Google it. That company has grown bigger and bigger over the years. And recently, in 2008-09, he actually donated, it's what we call endowment fund, a good amount of money to IIT Kharagpur to set up a bioenergy center. Because while in the US, he thought that could be the right area of research that we should pursue. So he wanted to support us. Prabha, in Hindi, he's from Bihar. In Hindi, actually, it's, again, Prabha means, in English, it's light. So I always, so in my title, you find a light-inspired journey. As I was telling you, the idea of doing research in a biorefinery model, whatever you do, you think that you are trying to do multiple tasking through that. That is what is a refinery approach. In refinery, we process crude oil and derive multiple products, you know, starting from LPG to naphtha to gas oil, diesel oil, you know, kerosene, in between gasoline, lighter fractions, and then you go down to bitumen, asphalt, and all this. Similarly, if you process anything, even our thoughts also, you can have multiple products out of it, multiple outputs. So in that kind of direction, we had moved forward and done something while deriving multiple products from microalgal or microbial. When I say microbial, maybe bacteria, yeast, we have worked on this. I'm not sure the exact focus of what you are doing right now, but you can also think about doing multitasking based on a feedstock. This feedstock can be water, wastewater can be feedstock, biomass can be feedstock, and something else. If it is chemistry, some, you know, kind of starting material can be feedstock, and then you derivatize it and get multiple derivatives of it. So all of you can connect to this concept or this philosophy. Fine, so what we are doing wastewater treatment while producing microbial surfactants, biosurfactants that are known for. And as you can see, these find applications in cosmetics, food, pharma, MUR again. I'll talk about that a little later. Biopigments, healthcare molecules. We have been working on some anti-cancer molecules, which are lipopeptides. Definitely, I'm a process technologist by training, so I join hands. I'm here also to look forward to joining hands with you. So every step that we take has a reason for it. So I would look forward to working with you. Then enzymes, mostly oriented towards biofuels, biomass processing. Then probiotics, nutraceuticals. Probioactive molecules like EPSS, which have, we have got a molecule which has very good anti-diabetic potential, anti-diabetic activities. Bioactives for therapy, that's what I would say. But while doing that, we have learned in this process of not ignoring these challenges. What is the energy input? Whether there is a net gain in energy at the end, whether we are again consuming fossil energy, but you know, advising all others to develop alternative energy. There's no point, isn't it? If we use fossil energy to develop something and asking others to develop alternative energy, it doesn't make a point. So what is that? What is the water input? Whether there is net water, potable, drinkable water gain or not. Land use change, again, real estate comes in this. GHG emissions. Whatever you do, try to calculate, estimate these parameters as well. What is the scale of operation? While doing it in the flask level or test tube level, can we envisage so much, you know, on the bigger scale? Or it is over, you know, kind of extrapolation. We have to be very careful about that. This is how, you know, I just consider them as landmarks in my life, milestones kind of which changed my thought process as to how to look at science and how to develop technologies while considering all the aspects. Sustainability issues, I think it was there on the left-hand side. Think about feedstock sustainability, environmental sustainability, energy sustainability, everything, whatever you do, connect to all these. To energy usage, land usage, water usage, environmental issues, financial issues. Then only you can do something good for the society, for the mankind. Actually, I was invited, and that's courtesy, Professor Somerville, Chris Somerville, who is heading the Energy Biosciences Institute in UC Berkeley. Suddenly, I got connected to him because of Prabha, Prabha Kansinan, the light who inspired me a lot. And then I was in this forum, and that actually brought about the first kind, you know, for the first time, policies on biofuels, bioenergy, and also biorenewables, the biorefinery concept. So that was the starting point. In 2009, and I was telling when I first interviews for my PhDs in 1992-93, I used to refer to MUR, microbial enhanced oil recovery, the role of biotechnology in enhancing oil recovery. And see, in 10 years from then, since then, 2003 onwards, people started talking about alternative energy. When I was fascinated by doing, you know, by oil recovery research, within 10 years, things changed, perspectives changed. People started talking about alternative energy. But then it drove me, you know, crazy, but I could not do the entire, could not implement the ideas which I had, the imagination that I had. But IIT Madras, Professor Karanth, he actually gave me some opportunity to work on biosurfactant, which is used in oil recovery. So from that, I started off, and then I started working on biosurfactants. And, you know, we tried to understand, as I said, process technology perspective, the commercial prospect, commercial potential of these molecules. And as we have, you know, moved up the learning curve with time, we found that these are wonder molecules. I hope you might have heard, some of you might have heard about Ananda Mohan Chakraborty. Dr. Ananda Mohan Chakraborty worked on these molecules long ago, in the 1970s. In fact, he actually developed a clone, Pseudomonas putida, which was used later on by USDE in Gulf War. That is the story. I'm not very sure, but I met him twice. He also kept mum about that because he was smart enough to transfer all these clones, which are patented. So these all, you know, the stories, the background captured my imagination. And then I tried to assess the commercial potential of all these when I started my journey in IIT Kharagpur from 2004 onwards. And then came the era of, you know, renewable energy. But still I tried to connect, struggle. I was trying to connect to, like to have the common thread between petroleum recovery, further enhanced recovery, and biorenewables, bioenergy. So in that transition, we actually had collaboration, you can see, University of California, Berkeley. I had a good student from them, and he wrote this, and he did some work in this direction. So that's how we could develop. But again, I owe all these things to Prabha, the light in my life. So while trying to grasp, you know, the scenario, the global scenario, map the global scenario around oil recovery through biotechnological route, oil recovery can happen through biotechnology route only from depleted reservoirs, not the nascent or virgin reservoirs. So once a reservoir is kind of considered to be depleted, abandoned, we can use biotechnological products, biosurfactants, bioemulsifiers. Why? Because in enhanced oil recovery technique, people used to use chemical surfactants, chemical polymers, all are derived from petroleum. These surfactants, polymers are all derived from petroleum. And we are using the byproducts of petroleum or other products of petroleum to recover petroleum. That's something funny, isn't it? We are using the products of the material, raw material, to recover the raw material. That way it cannot be sustainable. So that's why people started thinking about some sustainable solutions, and biotechnology offered to some extent, though it's a bit slow process, I would say a bit, but as far as depleted reservoirs, which are abundant in many countries, are concerned, this slowness of the process can be tolerated. So people started coming up with many ideas, in situ, ex situ, MUR, microbial enhanced oil recovery, and we tried to do something in that direction as well. But we also went by the logic that if you keep on using petroleum as the fuel which drives the civilization, definitely we'll keep on polluting the environment. It would be at the cost of environment that we'll be using petroleum. But we cannot suddenly shift overnight from petroleum economy to some bioenergy economy or bio-renewable economy. It takes time. During that transition, we tried to capture the global map, global scenario of bioethanol that become very, very, very popular in the US that time. You know, many companies, you know, many startups, what we talk about these days now in India, that came in the area, Indiana, California, many places. That time I got connected to UC Berkeley. They had a big project on bioethanol funded by BP. Okay, British Petroleum, $500 million, can you imagine? And that they set up a center, what is called Energy Biosciences Center, which was being headed by Chris Somerville. And I got to connected to Chris Somerville through Prava. So I'll take his name time and again, because whatever I am today, whatever we have been able to achieve, do, is because of his inspiration. While traveling with him, I learned certain things which I could not have learned otherwise. Like, you know, the sustainability issues. We are talking about, I hope you know, some aspects of bioethanol that people have been trying to derive bioethanol from lignocellulosic biomass. You know, the biomass that we grow, and then some part of biomass we don't use. So can it be used for, cellulose, hemicellulose production, and then sugar from there? Again, fermentation is well known, century old technology. So rest is fermentation. That's known. But what was not known was pretreatment of biomass, release of cellulose and hemicellulose, and conversion of that into sugar. That was the challenge to the community, scientific community. And those days, University of Illinois, Urbana-Champaign, University of California, Davis, California, Berkeley, they were working on tall grasses. There is a food versus fuel debate. I hope you understand that we should not use any biomass which has kind of food value. So corn cannot be used for bioethanol. Similarly, even molasses that we have been using, which can be used to derive even low-grade sugar, cannot be used because that will be serving as food for the community. So lignocellulosic biomass is the target. But those challenges were there. And from there, we actually had to take off. So those aspects we have covered here, and then did some work towards that. And we actually had chosen a very tough nut to crack kind of rice husk, which has a lot of silica, which has some cellulose and hemicellulose, but very difficult to pre-treat. Okay? So those days they were, nowadays, people are working on tall grasses, you know, miscanthus, switchgrass. And while traveling from Calcutta Airport to Kharagpur, I saw on both the sides some tall grasses. Okay? What you call, I don't know, in Bengal it's called hogla, which people use for making shelters, you know, in villages, and their huts. So I said, we have this tall grass. Why are they, struggling to grow miscanthus and switchgrass in their, lands, trying to do some genetic engineering and so on? We have this. I was excited, like a student. Then Prava asked me, see, where are they growing? They're all growing on the, on the water bodies, the lakes that you see, not like lakes, in a long water stretches on the roadside. So they're growing. So can you really have water to irrigate these grasses and grow them as feedstock for bioethanol? My eyes are open then. I didn't think about the water usage. So that came in because of Prava. So that's how a person's, like today, you know, a little interaction, brief interaction with the Honorable Director, Dr. Talukdar. So I had learned certain things, which will definitely take me forward in my thoughts, in my thinking process. So while capturing the global scenario, we found that there are many pretreatment processes all are using steam or alkali and ammonia. Can you do something which takes lesser time and a physical process which doesn't require much of chemicals? Because when you use chemicals, definitely discharge of that into water bodies, treatment of that, all those questions come. And then when you use a very high temperature for a longer time, inhibitors are generated, what you call furfurals, furan derivatives, which actually are detrimental in the next step, what is called enzymatic sacrification by those enzymes, cellulases. So what we can do so that we can avoid this? Wet air oxidation came handy, and we did this in collaboration with Niri Nagpur. They had some apparatus, we used that, and we developed this wet air oxidation improvised on this further with alkaline peroxide, but it takes very less time, though the temperature is as high as 160 degrees Celsius, but it's wet air, not steam. Kind of, you know, at that pressure and temperature, water vapor actually saturates air, so it becomes wet air, not steam. So that has more penetrating power, so it took very less time and did the job. Without producing furfurals or furan derivatives, without interfering with the enzymatic sacrification process subsequently. So that's how we did, and we actually had gone ahead and we could achieve good conversion of cellulose and hemicellulose later on into sugars by enzymatic sacrification. And we actually proposed this, which is kind of a conceptual process integration, wherein we actually proposed a separate hydrolysis and fermentation could be the best method using alkaline peroxide waste, wet air oxidation as a pretreatment procedure. And then suddenly biodiesel came into the picture. Government of India launched biodiesel mission without understanding those sustainability issues. That's what we are talking about, our government missionaries, which are mostly driven by IAS bureaucrats. So they do not consider things holistically. Without understanding the sustainability issues, biodiesel mission was launched in 2007. And to our surprise, it was owned up in 2009. Why? Because, you know, Jitrofa suddenly became a big hype. I hope you might have, at least through newspaper reports. And then suddenly, within 2 years, they realized, no, it cannot be sustainable feedstock. Where will you grow Jitrofa? Where is the land available? People were talking about wetland, wasteland. India doesn't have such land. So where will you grow Jitrofa? Can you grow Jitrofa in the land where you grow crops, agricultural crops? Then what will happen to the food security? Those questions came, and then they wound up this mission. But we started working on biodiesel and kept on working. So we worked on biodiesel, had some patents on it. Initially, we had some advantages. We actually tried to have not Jitrofa, but have another feedstock, and that we got from Orissa through an Indian, national professor, Professor P. Das. He was then the director of Sir Rice Plant Institute is there in Bhubaneswar. Rice Research. So he came from there to IIT Kharagpur. So we had a discussion, and then though it is considered to be a poisonous kind of, it causes dropsy. Argemon mexicana, you might have heard of some of the plant scientists, mexicana. So we actually started working on it, and it's a herb, weed, widely available in some parts of Orissa and Andhra Pradesh, and you know, animals don't graze it, so it doesn't require water for irrigation, all these things. So that captured our imagination. We had gone ahead with that, and actually we found the lacuna in literature that there was no method established to quantify biodiesel. People are talking about in terms of only fatty acid content of it and fatty acid composition of it. And some of us still do that kind of research. But we thought that no, that's a responsibility to develop an accurate method for biodiesel estimation. We had used HPTLC, high performance thin layer chromatography, that was available in our department and developed in terms of all these. while considering monoglyceride, diglyceride, free fatty acid, triglycerides, and this is the biodiesel, methyl ester. Even now also, people are under impression that anything which can be methyl ester or fatty acid is a biodiesel. That's not true. There are standards called ASTM standards, American Standard for Testing Materials. There are EN standards. We have to check whether the qualities or properties of biodiesel are matching, complying with the standards of these world standards. Then only you can call them, otherwise not. Okay? So we worked on this, and this rapid and precise estimation of biodiesel, because that was the requirement need of the day that time. And then suddenly you get connected to people, you know, whom you don't expect. So with this, whatever research output that we produced created somewhere some reference index. So one fine morning, a company from the US, PFP Technology LLC from Houston, USA, Texas, came to IIT Kharagpur. That was also kind of driven by an alumnus, Ashok Desarkar. You might see his name somewhere, Ashok Desarkar. So he's a billionaire, settled in the US. He came with a team, his consultants, all engineering and scientific consultants, and visited IIT Kharagpur, and they came with specific mission that we would visit this lab, that lab. So they came to my lab as well. I was not understanding why, but they found some research reports, some publications of ours, and they came. By the time we were doing something with enzymes, enzymatic conversion, and then we explained to him, he said, you just show, demonstrate, I'm giving you 2 hours. So I just called my students. In the morning, you know, people are not so ready, and the setup was not ready, but it was made ready within 1 hour or so, and we had demonstrated to him. So, and then when we had demonstrated to him, it was like this, very, very kind of, you know, trivial, like what we do in labs, you know, when we are not ready, we are not showcasing to somebody outside, that was looking like trivial, but his consultant was very much impressed. The way the reaction was done in a packed bed reactor system, it was not perfectly packed bed with plug flow, and then, you know, immediate separation of biodiesel and glycerol. And they saw within 5 minutes this happened, kind of a magic for them. I didn't understand because, you know, I thought it was something which were just repeating, being repeated by my students from literature. But, you know, that caught some attention of this guy, Jeff. And then he, you know, advised Ashok Desarkar, who is the chairman, MD again, alumnus of IIT Kharagpur, of PAP Technology LLC, and they funded. And see the semi-final form of it, which is at least looking, get-up-wise, looking better. And then we patented it. That's how things happen in life, and we learn lessons. You know, they ask some questions. They ask some questions, and from that also I've learned. I'm not getting into all these. So these are some biodiesel products which are produced from different oils. Vegetable oils, plant oils, waste cooking oil, and then tested those in the diesel engine. It's not that we have claimed out of nothing. So then tested and also matched with the specifications, ASTM. Because we got connected to the company, they forced us that you please check. Otherwise, we'll be just going fatty acid, methyl ester, biodiesel. That's not correct. Okay, somebody definitely might have done here also. So definitely you are checking with those. And we checked various parameters, and then came up with these. So we actually jointly filed a patent that was, I don't know where it is, yeah, this one. And that he got transferred kind of to his company. That is what the outcome that you know, happened in, our output that happened just in 1.5 years research. If it is driven by something, a vision, driven by somebody who is a visionary, then it will happen within a very short period of time. What would have otherwise taken maybe 3 to 4 years. Anyways, so then I got some, you know, message from the US, no, this conventional oil, vegetable oil feedstock, conventional feedstock that we know, plant sources, vegetable sources, are not going to work for biodiesel. It's the algae, what we call algae here, or algae in southern part of India. They say algae, we say algae, and in the US they say algae. So that could be the best feedstock. So third generation biofuel, while treating, because it actually draws light energy from sun, so no cost apparently, but there is a cost involved. There's no free lunch. That's what I've learned in my life. Wastewater, it's again, people say available freely. It's not free. See, a lot of energy has gone into it to make the wastewater. A lot of cost, a lot of manpower has gone into to make wastewater. So those we don't consider, apparently we say, bureaucrats will also think, wastewater is freely available. No, it's not free. A lot of cost has gone into that before making this. Here also, thermal power plant. So can we tap carbon dioxide? Can we tap wastewater? Can we tap sunlight and make microalgal factories in a biorefinery mode so that we can have biofuel, clean water, and fertilizer, animal feed, fish feed, and so on. Even some high-value products like phycobiliprate proteins, some high-value exopolysaccharides, and so on. So the vision is like, value proposition is water, energy, environment, health. They are all connected. You see here, and health is also connected, I'll show you. So there is a nexus between all these. So when you do research, think about all these, including the land that is being used, water that is being used, and so on. Time and again, I'm telling you, I hope most of you are very much junior to me, so that's why I'm telling you guys, okay? So as this is the vision, and we have been able to achieve something in this with the help of West Bengal Department of Science and Technology in collaboration with Kulaghat Thermal Power Plant. And then we got a project, another call from CSIR. They asked me to work on this. I didn't know much about algae that time. And they said, no, you have to only work on biodiesel aspect of it. And then we developed in collaboration with CSMCRI Bhavnagar. I'll be visiting day after tomorrow, in 2-3 days' time. And we got the strain from there, marine strain of Chlorella variabilis. We developed the process. But the real challenge in algal biofuels, algal biorefineries, harvesting of biomass, dewatering of biomass, what you call. Because there will be huge amount of water as compared to the solid, the biomass. So how to get rid of this water? Usually in lab we do centrifugation. But when we are centrifuging, you have to ask, where is the energy coming from? So coming from fossil fuel, from petroleum or coal. So can you use that? We are developing an alternative to fossil fuel. So can you use that energy to do centrifugation? No. Can you do microfiltration? Where is the energy coming from? Where the microfilters are coming from? Centrifuge, all actually have used in developing or making, fabricating, manufacturing fossil energy. Can you use them? If not, then what else? So these are certain cost-effective processes, sustainable materials. So you can see these are nothing but adsorbents which are there under this cloth. Under this cloth, natural adsorbents which we just tweaked and tinkered to have a patent on it. And then dewatering was done and we could patent on this as well. We worked on a raceway, 400 liter capacity. At that time it was a good capacity in any academic institute. Though CSMCRI was doing in salt basins, in Bhavnagar, they have salt basins, so they were using them as kind of reservoir ponds, and they could produce more biomass than us and could produce biodiesel and ran the cars in CSIR Delhi, Anushandhan Bhavan, in the presence of the then Science and Technology Minister, I think Deshmukh maybe. So they came into the newspaper, okay, part of this, but we could not produce so much in an academic institute limited by design, space, and all other parameters. So that's how we produce algal biomass, process it, dry it, and then SOx lead, but we have now improved upon it. We have done in situ transesterification process, not using solvent, but very little amount, and recycling it time and again in situ. There itself, lipid extraction and biodiesel transesterification process happening simultaneously. I hope I'm not boring you, just few slides. So in collaboration with Kolhapur Thermal Power Plant, we got all the heat transfer data of their flue gas generator. We designed our flue gas generator there in collaboration with the mechanical engineering department. and developed this, you know, kind of as flue stack. Okay, we used to get flue gas passing through smoke filter, then SOx NOx scrubber, and then we used to store in small cylinders. From there, we were sparging in Resway pond, this is our pond only. And then we are doing another dewatering using bioelectricity. That is coming from microbial fuel cells. So using that small amount of electricity, we were doing dewatering in small scale. Definitely, we would scale up MFCs, we can scale up this as well. And we are using, since it was coming out of, you know, thermal power plant coal, we are doing toxicity test where the heavy metal concentration is more, and using that as that biomass for animal and fish feed. That is the setup. DST, DBT, actually they visited and appreciated that it was kind of an integrated process, integrated. Am I taking more time and just? Okay, so that is how we can discuss further on this. Some pictures of what we have done. So this is basically a photobioreactor, 30 liter scales to develop inoculum for these raceway ponds. And we have, this is 60 liters twin raceway ponds, and we also have 400 liter raceway pond. So we, you know, came up with some sort of, you know, so process integration, that part was, you know, was leveraged, and we could achieve certain things in a biorefinery model. We could process, we could produce biofuels, we could produce animal feed, fish feed, biofertilizer, while processing wastewater, while capturing carbon dioxide. So multiple things, multitasking, that is what I was telling you, happening in just one process module, in a modular approach, and that's how we could do. So we also used some liquid and solid wastes treated in that procedure. So waste to energy, waste to wealth, waste to biofuel, and all these we have tried and established. And that's how algae-based carbon capture and biorefinery, the entire concept is here, has been proved and established. Then we present to the outside world. Otherwise, we just keep, you know, I'm not sure whether this will work just for... this is the working of the flue gas setup. So that's how it is, you know. If I could fast forward it. So in climate research, we have been able to do something, though quantification hasn't been done so far. So I have sent my student to University of Pennsylvania through that Fulbright program. So she's now there in University of Pennsylvania working on this climate research aspect of it in collaboration. So here we actually store the flue gas carbon dioxide, which is typically 10 to 12% in the flue gas. And then we spurge into this algal pond through different, you know, inject ports. And we are improvising on it further for better mass transfer. And also, we have taken into consideration the heat and mass balances, energy balances in that around this particular integrated process. So that's how, I mean, it will. So next is. So our engineering vision perspective is like this: we'll work in collaboration with a power plant. We'll take the flue gas, try to reduce emission. How we'll run this carbon recycle CCR. People talk about CCS, carbon dioxide capture and sequestration. But as far as algal biological sequestration is concerned, it's not really sequestration. Sequestration is something which has to be done to capture carbon dioxide for not less than 100 years. Anything, if it's captured by biomass, it will be degraded and CO2 would be out in the environment. So that's not sequestration. So we are calling it carbon dioxide capture and recycle. So that's the vision. I'll just go fast. So here we are proposing that the biomass that we generate may be co-fired with coal. While reducing coal consumption, we can reduce emissions. And this biomass can be recycled in that. And we can extract all value-added products and also lipid for, you know, PUFA, MUFA, and biodiesel, carbohydrate for bioethanol, and so on. And while treating wastewater as well. So that is how we... We are also working on East Microbial, so East Biorefinery, with the same vision, you know, producing fuel with other products. This bioemulsifier has potential to be a good anti-cancer agent and also can be used in food, pharma, and other processing, other industries. Recently, we have used that biomass and have got a patent in the US patent, on water purification. Now we have just given a part of the study, fluoride and halides removal, but we are also working on heavy metals. We can also go for a patent for this. Coming to Professor Deka's field of research, a lot of research has been done, but I will just show some footprints in the healthcare. We actually had gone ahead to work on these surfactants, which are lipopeptides, fatty acids connected to hexapeptide or heptapeptide with, you know, some amino acids attached to it. So what we have, we collected some samples from very serene, unpolluted environment of Andaman Nicobar and got some good strains. And then, you know, we developed a process in small-scale reactor long ago, 2010-12. And then we have scaled it up to 15-liter scale and, you know, used very, I would say, cost-effective as a filtration system to semi-purify it. So crude lipopeptide is almost 80% pure. And then went for chromatographic steps and then further purified. And now we have, not now, in 2012 onwards, we are able to produce 95% pure lipopeptide, which has been found to have significant anti-cancer activity and broad-spectrum antimicrobial activity. You know, chemobiotherapeutic, you know, applications, something which is really broad-spectrum antibiotic can be used as a chemotherapeutic agent as well. So these are iturine, surfactant, and fengicin molecules. And we have assessed the potential therapeutic applications of biosurfactants in collaboration with University of Minho, Portugal. And also worked in collaboration with Professor Mandal, who is a cancer biologist. So I joined hands with him. You know, he did all the tests in animal cell culture in different cancer cell lines with the purified molecules that we produced in the lab. So we also tested broad spectrum antibiotic activity in collaboration with Peerless Hospital. So tried to do something, you know, which is tested, verified by the relevant people. We didn't claim anything, which we got something like in the lab. We had gone ahead, collaborated with the relevant people, expertise, with relevant expertise, and then got this. So these are some results published long ago, I think 2008. And the real challenge in this sector was to produce a biosurfactant. Professor Deka is not here in the critical moment. Non-hemolytic, so those who are his students, I hope you know hemolytic and non-hemolytic. So the biosurfactants or lipopeptides known so far are mostly hemolytic in nature. They lyse erythrocytes, red blood cells. They cannot qualify as candidate drugs, isn't it? Though they show promising anti-cancer, antimicrobial activities, they cannot because of one bad property, that is hemolytic, hemolysis. So we actually had taken up that challenge. We were lucky enough to have that Andaman Nicobar Islands culture, which actually gave us a non-hemolytic. So sigma surfactant, which is available commercially, actually could hemolyze kind of lyse erythrocytes, blood cells of goat blood. But our lipopeptide did not show that. So it has more potential to qualify as a candidate drug. We also tested against biofouling, biofilm removal, kind of what is very important in case of surgery, you know, internal catheters, you know, surgical implants, they grow microbes, you know, on it. And these biofilms can be removed by our surfactant. So these are some therapeutic and biomedical applications, anti-adhesive properties. Some tests were done on animal cell culture, they say breast cancer cell lines, sorry. So they were tested and see within 48 hours with very low MIC value. It's given, all these things are given here. I worked in collaboration with Professor Mahitosh Mandal, who is an eminent cancer biologist, worked in Anderson for 10 years or so, was selectively active against cancer cells and not against normal cells. That was a challenge to prove. We have also done something in the area of nano with the help of these biosurfactants. And so these are some, you know, photographs which are convincingly establishing the anti-cancer potential of it. You can see with increasing dosage, the size of the tumor, volume of the tumor is decreasing. So all these are published in some journals, in scientific reports, and in IASST Advances. And also, we have been able to publish in Oncogene, which is a good journal. Finally, coming to this, so I'm just summing up everything, but the onus, the responsibility is on us, you see, to save our globe. So do something towards that and try to achieve what this man has been able to achieve. We have to be like this man, okay? We have to save the deer, our dear planet, from the tiger, which is the menace of the tigers. We have to be like this man, okay? So thank you very much for all your attention, the opportunity. I thank my students, my teachers, who have shown me the light, shown me the ways, my friends, philosophers, and guides, my students. There are many students I can't name. Already 20 almost have got PhD. All my colleagues, collaborators, and above all, critics, who actually doubted our abilities, they helped us in that process. All the funding agencies, my family, friends, and well-wishers, and also Chris Somerville, I was taking his name, the director of Energy Biosciences Institute, University of California, Berkeley, Prabha Kant Sinha, the light in my life. Through him, I got connected to him. And of course, finally, the one infinite, pure, and holy, beyond thought, beyond qualities, and I bow down to thee. Thanks to Swamiji. Thank you very much.